So what did you hear in all that? Well, I heard a lot of reduplicated babbling, da 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 da. But what was interesting is those twins are using a lot of really great prosody, right? So you could tell when one of them was asking a question, it was da 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 da, da 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 da. You had a rising pitch at the end. And other times it was da 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 da. So you heard the lowering pitch at the end, which was probably more of a statement. I heard one true word in there, up, when the twin on the, I guess on the right side, the one holding onto the fridge, picked up his foot, said up. I also saw a lot of really great gestures, and the giggles were just fantastic. I love that video. So we're continuing our discussion on infancy and language development, okay? And we're gonna start today on category formation and talking about how categories are formed in the brain, and then we're gonna just move right on through infancy. Hopefully we're going to finish infancy today. Okay, so let's get started. I want you guys to kind of think about our brains kind of like a filing cabinet, okay? We have all these files that hold on to different categories, that hold on to our lexicon, okay? And it's filed in an organized way so that we can quickly retrieve the information we need, okay? Their words are kind of placed into those folders, and we kind of can go through the folders to pick things out, okay, and to find our words. Well, infants are starting that categorical learning, okay? They start to file things into categories. And your book talks about that an infant's ability to actually create these categories early on is indicative of their cognitive abilities later on. And that kind of makes sense, right? If you have an easier time learning the categories or where language goes, where different words go, then you're probably going to have an easier time learning in general. And you're going to have a higher vocabulary and more cognitive skills. Whereas children who maybe have a really hard time developing those categories and developing word meanings and putting them together for easy retrieval might have lower cognitive functioning, okay? So, let's see. Category formation for infants is hierarchical, which just means that there are different levels and they get more complex the deeper they go, okay? Let's kind of use those file folders again, okay? Now, babies, there's the three different levels, and your book has a really good diagram of this, but you have the superordinate level, which is the uppermost level, okay? So it's something like, let's use furniture as an example, okay? Furniture is the big top category. Okay, within furniture, you might have desk, chair, table, couch, all right? So those would be at the basic level, okay? Those are the basic words that are kind of in the middle, okay? The subordinate level are the individual names of different things. So we have different kinds of tables. We have coffee tables, end tables, nightstands, dining room tables, right? We have different kinds of chairs. We have recliners. We have a desk chair. We have a dining chair. We have outdoor chairs, okay? Those are the subordinate levels. Now, infants, as they're learning language, they learn those basic things first, which makes sense. We're naming things for infants all the time. So they have that concrete, exact name for something, right? This desk chair is a chair. The chair downstairs is a chair. They don't necessarily have those subordinate level where they have the specific items in the category. They have the basic level. I know chairs. Now, eventually they'll learn that chairs fall under the category, that upper category of furniture. But first off, they're just learning everything on that basic level, okay? But we have the superordinate level, the top level that is the big category name. So furniture, vehicles, animals, right? If we can use animals as an example, okay? Animals is the superordinate level. Dog might be one of the items in the basic level. And the subordinate level would be things like mastiffs, beagles, Maltese, terriers, Okay? Does that make sense? Hopefully. All right. So, like I said, their first categories are at the basic level, and the first words are those basic level words. Okay? You might use the category of people, the people in their life, mommy, daddy. For Roan, it would be Oma and Opa, or Mimi is his other grandma. Okay? There are two different types of categories that infants utilize at each level of the hierarchy. There's perceptual categories and conceptual categories, okay? Now, when we're talking about perceptual categories, let's see, that's on the next slide, so we'll move forward. Perceptual categories are based on similar appearing features like color, shape, texture, size, okay? They're used to identify things around them. It's things that you can see about them that are different or the same within that category. Perceptual categorization describes knowing what something looks like, whereas conceptual categorization describes knowing what something is. Okay, so the conceptual categorization, you know the name of something. It's based on what things do rather than what they look like. Okay, so your book uses the example of a penguin, a real penguin versus a toy penguin, okay? Babies know that toys don't really get up and walk around on their own. So when it looks at the toy penguin, it's not necessarily expecting that penguin to get up, walk around, that kind of thing. It's expecting it to act like another toy. Whereas when it looks at a real penguin, it kind of sees that that's an animal. It's going to move around on its own. It's going to eat. It's going to make noise. Okay? Those are part of the conceptual categories. It looks at what the thing does. I have another example of like a real banana versus like a wooden toy food banana. Again, the kid would know that a real banana I can eat. Now I have a toy banana and I might orally explore that toy banana, but I'm not going to be able to chew it up and swallow it like I would the real banana. Okay, so that's part of conceptual categorization. So what does something do versus what does it look like, feel like, etc. Does that make sense? So perceptual categories, what you can experience about it, what it looks like, feels like. Conceptual categories are really what it does. And babies are looking at that for all the different levels of categorization, okay? Now, different languages, your book talks about, they categorize things differently. And so be sure you take a look at that in your textbook about how, I think they use Korean, if I'm not mistaken, I might be, but how we have tight fit versus loose fit versus, I think, big and small, I think. So take a look at that and read that over so that you have that understanding of how languages kind of differ in those conceptual categories. All right, so we have early vocalizations with infants, all right? These are just the noises and the sounds that infants make, and they follow a pretty regular pattern, okay? Pretty predictable pattern in how they use their vocalizations, okay? So we have the stage model that describes an infant's vocalizations to follow an observable and sequential pattern, okay? They describe it as having six stages of early vocalization development, okay? Reflexive, which is 0 to 8 weeks, control of phonation, which is 6 to 16 weeks, expansion, 4 to 6 months, control of articulation, 5 to 8 months, canical syllables, 6 to 10 months, and advanced forms, 10 to 18 months. We're gonna go over each of these, all right? So reflexive vocalizations are those vocalizations that the baby just makes naturally, crying, gurgling, fussing, burping, Roan used to kind of, you know, just early vocalizations. They don't really have control over them. They just happen, okay? As adults, we respond to them and we reinforce them. Crying, of course, we're responding to, and we're figuring out what types of cries mean what. The little hums and things like that. We might talk back to the baby, even though the baby wasn't intending anything. We're going to reinforce those things. And that a lot of times leads to the babies using their voices a bit more. And moving into the control of phonation, okay? So this is where the coos and the goos come from. Now, if you think about it, babies spend a lot of time on their back, right? So why would coo and goo be first? Well, if they're spending a lot of time laying down, where's the tongue? In the back of the throat, in the back of the mouth, and makes it really easy for it to articulate with that velum and do goo, 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 things like that. They start to play with their sounds, use some vowels. Roan did a lot of nasal was a lot of humming. And infants really mostly only breathe through their nose at first. That's why babies get real upset when they have their first colds, because they don't really know how to breathe through their mouth. They do start to make some noises orally, but they're not good at breathing through their mouth. That was something I learned through having an infant that I didn't know before. Early consonant sounds are easier for infants to produce than those sounds that require more precise manipulation of the tongue, lips, or teeth. They're not, at this stage, able to really even do the ba, 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 open and close of the mouth. They're just kind of playing with the sounds as they come out and wherever their tongue happens to be. So that's a lot of times why it's the coo and goo, all right? And it's really not really a full oo. It's more of a goo, 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 goo. So there's not as the rounding of the lips necessarily for that. All right, expansion, 4 to 6 months. They gain more control over their articulators. This is a really fun period with infants. They're producing a series of vowel sounds as well as vowel glides. Ay, 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 ee. They experiment with loudness and pitch of their voices. So a lot of screeching and a lot of ah kind of things that go on. Roan loves the heavy metal growl because his daddy models that for him a lot and he thinks it's very funny. They start to make the raspberries with their lips and think those are very fun to watch, and a lot of kinds of things. So they're starting to play a lot more during this period of time with their vocal abilities, and they're enjoying the sensation of it as well. Part of this play is feeling the way different sounds feel in their oral cavity and larynx. This early infant vocalizations are one component of a dynamic mother-infant communication system, whereby patterns of mother-infant communication relate to infant vocalizations. During this period of time, moms or primary caregivers really spend a lot of time imitating their babies, making sounds back. You start to get more of that eye contact. You start to get more of the interaction from the baby, that they're excited to interact with you and they're interested in the noises that you're making, and even can sometimes start to imitate a little bit. And so this is a period of time where moms get real excited and do a lot of that play, vocal play with their babies, and it's really, really important. All right, between 5 and 8 months, babies start to do some marginal babbling, short strings of consonant-like and vowel-like sounds. This happens as they start to get more control over their articulators. So things like ba, 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 ma, as you know, trying to start doing open and close of the mouth, getting closer and closer to that real reduplicated or canonical babbling. All right, canonical. All right, true babbling appears between 6 and 10 months. It contains pairs of consonants and vowels called CV, consonant vowel sequences, when the consonant precedes the vowel. Reduplicated means they repeat the consonant and vowel pairs, ma 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 ba 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 da da da, as we saw in that video in the beginning, those little ones with the da 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 da, right? They are adorable, and that's that reduplicated babbling, okay? Non-reduplicated or variegated babbling is non-repeated consonant and vowel combinations. So ma da ba ga da ba do do do. We didn't hear a lot of that in that video, but there probably will be some other videos where we'll see some of that, or maybe for your discussion board you're going to come up with some of those. And that's really fun. A lot of times that has some really fun prosody too, like those two little ones did. Infants prefer nasal sounds and stop sounds in their variegated babbling, and you know, that just kind of makes sense to me. Nasal sounds are really easy, and you can really feel them in your nose. There's sensory to that, as well as a da 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 da. It's kind of, those are easy sounds to make with the tongue just hitting the top, and there's also a lot of feeling with those as well. Da 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 da. You feel the air stop and go, and it also is kind of loud. So I could see why that, you know, just common sense wise, would be some of the first sounds that babies are excited about and using. They start to do whispered vocalizations, so they're playing with that sound. They start to get some of the rounded vowels and the high front vowels. And the syllable combinations are kind of similar to adult speech. So they're using combinations that they're hearing regularly in speech, not necessarily making up some random ones. They're really kind of coming up with sounds that they've heard before. All right, those advanced forms, 10 to 18 months, you have the diphthongs, where you have two vowels within the same syllable, and you get more complex combinations of consonants versus vowels, or consonants and vowels, I'm sorry. So CVCs, bup, 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 bum, mum, 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 CCV, so gub, gub, things like that. Vowel, consonant, vowel, abba, abba, abba. Okay? Jargon is a special type of babble that contains the melodic patterns of an infant's native language. So what we saw with those twins at the beginning, that they had some jargon going on there, right? They weren't really doing much of the variegated babbling, but you could definitely hear the prosody and the melodic structures of their native language. They're not true words because they're not referential and don't contain meaning. And we'll talk about true words as we get into this a little bit more, okay? In the same way that vocalizations of infants who hear speech mimic the specific rhythmic patterns that bind syllables, so too do the hand movements of babies born to parents who are deaf. So this is interesting. Babies who are born to someone, to a couple maybe who's deaf or are deaf themselves, their babbling is done with their hands instead of vocally. Okay, and this is true even if it's a hearing baby born to a deaf family or deaf parents. If the deaf parents don't have that baby around hearing folks a whole lot and they're not hearing a ton of language, that they're seeing more sign than they are anything else, they're going to babble with their hands, which is really neat. They don't have that fine motor coordination, as you saw with those little ones we were watching just a little bit ago. They don't have a lot of fine coordination. I mean, it was a lot of this and that kind of thing, but those babies who are seeing sign language all the time are going to do a whole lot more with their hands than they are vocally, okay? But it's interesting to note that deaf babies do still do those reflexive sounds and that first stage of making sounds, but because they don't have the reinforcement of the auditory for that, a lot of times that babbling starts to die away. Verbal babbling, anyway, starts to die away as they get older because they don't have the reinforcement for making the sound.
Excuse me.
All right. Some of the early foundations for language development are infant-directed speech, joint reference and attention, rituals of infancy, and caregiver responsiveness. And we're going to talk about a few others as well as we go through this. Remember, we've talked about this and talked about this and talked about this, and it's only chapter 5, but the environment is so important for language development. Right? You saw in the Genie video that she didn't have language in her environment, and therefore she didn't have language, okay? Your environment is so important to language development. The adults in the environment are providing all of that linguistic input. They're providing the models, the infant-directed speech. They're providing everything for that child to be able to learn language, so it's super important. And then we're also going to talk about some of the social interactions that infants engage in with others. Just a quick note on that, you know, I've taken Roan out to the mall or something, and it's so much fun to watch him interact with anybody who's interested in interacting with him. In fact, he'll watch people, and if they walk by and don't interact with him and talk to him, because he's aware that he's cute and that, you know, people should want to talk to him, he kind of gives them this look like, wait a minute, don't you know who I am? You you should be stopping to talk to me. I want to interact with you. So, you know, babies are really excited a lot of the time, depending on their personality, to smile at others, to get reinforced for their smiles, to get reinforced for their vocalizations. They enjoy that social piece. And as they get older, they start to do some of those gestures. They start to wave high and bye. They might nod their head. Those babies were doing a lot of this with shaking their head. I wonder who in their environment's doing that on a regular basis. So babies really do enjoy that social engagement with others. So let's talk about infant-directed speech, okay? Infant-directed speech is also called motherese or baby talk. And I wanted to show you a couple of quick videos about this before we kind of go on. So let's start with the motherese.
Oh,
hey, pause and bring it over here so you can see it. And we're gonna go big and switch here. Oh, nope, not there. We're gonna go here. All right, here we go.
In the beginning was not the word. In the beginning was the sound. The sound that warns, that soothes, that pleases, that attracts attention.
Good boy.
This is the song of Mother Ease, the unique pattern of sounds that caregivers the world over used to communicate with infants.
In our research, we look at how people speak to other adults and how people speak to babies. They turn out to be quite different. When you're talking to an adult, you use lower frequency, you speak more quickly, the pauses are shorter, the utterances are longer. If I were a German greeting you, I might say, ja, wie geht es Ihnen? Heute ist es sehr schön. The German mother talking to a baby would sound quite different. She'd say, ja, bist du schön? Ja, toll. It's a much more musical form.
Say hi, mommy. Say hi, mommy.
We've done research in a number of different European cultures, Asian cultures, and in all of these cultures, when we observe mothers talking to adults and mothers talking to babies, we find the same dramatic differences. There are important cultural and linguistic differences, but the universal melodies seem to emerge whenever a baby is the person being talked to.
So he's on the telephone. He's on the telephone. You want to talk to somebody? Say hi, Daddy.
Daddy. Hi, Daddy.
Now, the real question is, do babies know the difference? Is this just something we do for our own amusement, or is this really having a predictable effect on babies' behavior?
In other words, could tuning in to this early communication system be a part of baby's biology? If it is, the language being spoken, German, English, Japanese, shouldn't matter. The survival message should be in the music, not the lyrics.
Peek-a-boo! Peek-a-boo! Where's Noah?
In one of Dr. Fanal's experiments, a baby with English-speaking parents. Here's a tape of a woman speaking Japanese, a language the baby obviously doesn't understand. The woman first speaks Japanese motherese. And then, normally, as if to an adult. The baby discovers that it can control how long each voice plays by how long it looks at a red and white checkerboard screen. The researchers then compare the times and have found that the infants clearly prefer the motherese version.
What's that, Joe?
Uh-oh.
Oh. I'm saying he's wet.
What's that?
I have to go inside the shoes
over there.
Is that Daddy?
It's in again.
Say, Dad, them shoes?
Fanald draws a parallel between her work and that of scientists who study calls in other animals. The sounds, from motherese to the warning call of a monkey, have the same function, survival.
They're really grounded in our biology and in our evolutionary history. When you want to arouse attention, to alert a child, you use a high-frequency sound that's going to get the baby to look at you. when you want to warn the child, keep him from heading over the stairs, keep her from touching the hot surface, then you say something short and sharp and loud, because that's a good way to interrupt behavior, and that's what you want to do at that point. So these are biologically based in a way that accounts for their cultural universality.
Whee! Boom! Ah, boom! Ah, boom! Ah, boom!
All right. Close that. And we have one more I want to show you before we move on here. If I can get it to work, maybe I need to do here. There we go. This is kind of a simple one.
Good evening. I'm Stephen Barrister, and welcome to a very special edition of BBC News. Tonight, we're going to be taking a close look at a mysterious epidemic affecting the speech patterns of adults with newborn children. Left unchecked, it has turned otherwise normal men and women into blathering morons. Take a look at this clip, but I must warn you, it's rather graphic.
Yes! Oh, he's a good baby! Oh, I'm a good baby! Oh, yes, I am, too! Yes, you do! Do you want a bubble?
Ooh, nasty business that. Thankfully, however, in the majority of cases, the problem is temporary and seems to resolve itself once the baby has grown. But what's the reason behind this sudden lack of coherency in otherwise unafflicted adults? Does the stress of birth cause a mental breakdown? Do babies carry a previously undetected pathogen that targets the adults around them? Our investigative reporter, Brian Mooney, has tried to find out more. Thank you, Stefan. Brian Mooney here. And to get to the bottom of this story, I interviewed experts all over the globe. But tonight, I'm here with Professor Friedrich von Krauthammer, a language expert, and he claims this affliction actually plays an important role in helping children develop their language skills. Preposterous, yet true. Here's what he has to say.
Yeah, this affliction that you speak of is actually something we like to call infant-directed speech. Perhaps you've heard of parentese or baby talk. Baby talk is infant-directed speech. It is something that all parents across the world, different cultures, different languages, use to speak with their children. It is short sentences, baby won't bother, but spoken with high-pitched sing-song voice, baby won't bother, with the words spoken clearly yet the vowels dragged out, baby won't bother. Research has shown that actually that mode of speaking is very effective to help the babies learn and to remember longer the words, the language. They learn it better, faster, and remember it longer. The prevailing theory as to why that is so is because the infant-directed speech is much more interesting for the baby to pay attention to. The exaggerated pitch contours for approval is up, down, up, down. Very good! For comfort is low falling contours. It's okay, it's okay. For disapproval of a behavior is flat, short, no, no. That plus the exaggerated body language and very animated facial expressions of infant-directed speech tend to grab the infant's attention and keep it. And once that happens, the baby is free to then learn the language easier from the short, simple sentences.
Well, there you have it, folks. Thanks for tuning in. And as always, have a great night.
All right, so that one's a little bit silly, but it does give you a really good idea of what infant-directed speech and mother ease is, okay? It's a speech we use with young children and babies, okay? And at each stage it changes, but with really little babies, I mean, you know, I was thinking more about this week as I was talking to Roan and I'm reading for this lecture and preparing, and I do it. I don't even realize I'm doing it, but I do it all the time. Oh, hi, Roan. Like, the O is so much longer in his name than it needs to be. But when I talk about him on here, I'm like, Rome. But when I'm talking to him, oh, Rome, what are you doing? You know, everything is extended. Everything is there's greater pitch differences. There's greater volume differences. I'm really working to give him a lot more feedback than I am when I talk with an adult. So, you know, that's what mother ease is. And we all do it with babies kind of instinctually. It's amazing. Paralinguistic characteristics describe the manner of speech outside the linguistic information. So high overall pitch, exaggerated pitch contours, slower tempos, stretching out vowels. And that's when we're comparing it to adult speech, like what I'm doing with you right now. Okay, the syntactic characteristics are that we use smaller mean length of utterance, shorter sentences, fewer clauses, more content words, fewer function words. We're using things to make it easier to understand, okay? So we use a lot more repetition with babies. We ask a lot of questions. How are you doing? Oh, what do you have? You have a ball? Oh, you hear all those, the pitch differences, asking all the questions. We do it automatically. It attracts infants' attention, and infants prefer it to adult-directed speech, even as newborns, okay? And you saw that in that first video, that study that they did where the baby realizes that it can control which type of speech is coming at them based on the amount of time they're looking at that red and white checkerboard. Even though it was in a language not their own, the baby preferred the sound of the mother ease as opposed to just adult talking, okay? All this aids in communicating emotion and speaker's intent, and it looks like, and we saw in that video, that it kind of happens universally, okay? All the different languages, all the different cultures, everybody talks to babies this way, instinctually. It just happens, and I think that's really kind of neat. It is a universal thing. All right. It contains exaggerated vowels. We've talked about that. It highlights the content words, nouns and verbs, instead of like prepositions and articles, things like that. We really highlight naturally kind of things that are in that basic category, naming things and action words. And when we use those words, we use them with exaggerated pitch and stress to give the baby kind of an idea of, oh, this is an important word. I need to pay attention to that. So, oh, you have a ball? Ball. I'm extending out that vowel. I'm using a higher pitch. And it's clear that that's the important word of the sentence. And the baby's holding the ball. So hopefully that baby is realizing, oh, this thing that mom just mentioned is ball, right? Again, it places the words on exaggerated pitch peaks at the end of utterances where infants are likely to remember them, like I just talked about with ball. Exaggerates pauses, creating a salient cue to help infants detect major syntactic units of speech. So when we put in a pause, oh, you have a ball? We put a pause there so the baby has a little bit more attention. Oh, we stopped and then we put something else in there. We stopped, mom stopped talking and then she said something else. Oh, that must be important, okay? And that helps babies break into that speech stream again. We've talked about that several times in class and in our lecture in class, we talked about how the babies need to be able to break into that speech stream. And our use of mother ease and these pitch break, the pitch changes, the pauses, that all helps them break into it and learn those words, okay? Rhythm is marked by the presence of reliable acoustic correlates of both utterance and phrase boundaries in other languages as well. So again, all this stuff can be really universal to other languages. Okay. The next thing we have is joint reference and attention, okay? And this is really fun when babies start to develop this because you both are attending to the same thing or they're interested in directing your attention to something. And that is always so cool because it is the beginning of them realizing that there's something outside of themselves and they want you to be a part of it, okay? So Vygotsky talks about that language is a dynamic process that occurs within a child's zone of proximal development as they engage with more advanced peers and adults, okay? And Adamson and Chance in 1998 stated that there are three major developmental phases with respect to joint reference and attention. So there's three different steps to gaining this. So emergence to social partners, emergence and coordination of joint attention, and transition to language. So they all babies go through these three stages as they're on their way to language. Okay. So, we as adults always kind of view infants and what they're doing as meaningful through the lens of our own culture, which means, you know, those of us who live here in America, we might have one view of a child's intentionality and a child's utterances or sounds that they're making or actions that they're doing, whereas another culture might find certain actions like direct eye contact with adults not appropriate, right? So we base all of this based on our own cultures, okay? And as the adults in the child's environment, hopefully we're supporting their expressions until they can independently tell us what they mean, okay? And they are independently mastering those social language things. So, you know, when the baby, you know, looks over at something and, oh, you want that? Let's get that down. Let's go get that. You know, we are supporting what they look like they're interested in, and we're helping them gain access to that until they're able to really tell us what it is that they want. Hopefully that made sense. Okay, so phase one, birth to 6 months, infants are developing patterns of attending to social partners, okay? They value and participate in interpersonal interactions, learning how to maintain attention and be organized with sustained periods of engagement. They become interested in looking at people's faces, especially the faces of their parents, and caregiver responsiveness is an important feature. So between birth and 6 months, babies are learning to look at you. They are learning to give you eye contact. You know, when you're changing their diaper, you're talking to them and you're looking at their eyes. And when they're laying on the floor playing with something, you try and get involved and look at the toy with them. You're always kind of, we spend a lot of time with babies within, you know, 2 to 3 feet of their faces, right? We're in that space all the time, and they're really tuned in to looking at and enjoying looking at their parents' faces or the people that are in their direct environment that they're around all the time. That's really what they're into. And this makes sense for language learning, right? That's where your lips and teeth are. That's where you're smiling at them, where your eyes are. This is all part of learning to be socially interactive. If caregivers aren't responding to the babies looking at them or vocalizations or, you know, being really in their space and in their faces, they're not learning as much about language and moving on to that next level for joint attention, right? They're craving that interaction, and the more that parents are interacting with them during this phase, the better off they're going to be. All right, between 6 months and 1 year, they start to have an interest in looking at and manipulating the objects around them. Toys are so much fun right now for Roan. He's 7 months today. And so he is so enjoying the different toys we have. We have a bubblegum dispenser looking thing that he gets to put the balls in, and that's really exciting. He pushes a button and it lights up and a ball drops down. It's very, very exciting. He loves to interact with that with us. We just got him a xylophone type thing, and he loves to bang on that and see that it makes noise and that he can do it. Ring stackers, things like that. They love the toys. They're starting to really enjoy manipulating things around them and causing things to happen, okay? And they start to want to share that excitement with you. So they begin to navigate their attention between an object that they're enjoying and you, the caregiver, or another person, okay? And this is starting the emergence of joint attention. And joint attention is the simultaneous engagement of two or more individuals in mental focus on a single object of focus, okay? So if we're all gonna be focused on, I use this pen a lot, it's just sitting here on the desk, but we're going to all focus on this pen. Ooh, it's a really neat pen. And I'm looking at the pen and I'm looking at my partner and I'm looking back at the pen. This is exciting. I like this pen. And I want to be sure that you're sharing in this excitement with me. This is joint attention, okay? It symbolizes a critical avenue for early communication, because if you're not both attending to the conversation later on, you're not having a conversation, right? So joint attention is one of those really major foundational things that if babies don't get, it really can impact their language later on. And actually, it's one of the very first indicators of autism is a lack of developing joint attention. So it's always something you want to look out for in little ones. All right. Supported joint engagement are techniques such as speaking with an animated voice or showing an infant novel objects in order to kind of get them to pay attention to something with you, okay? It's helping them maintain attention related to an infant's ability to engage and sustain attention at 18 months. So, you know, we don't expect an infant to have an attention span of 10 minutes, right? So it is a short amount of time with babies, but we're wanting them to be able to maintain attention on something. Now, redirecting an infant's attention is negatively related to an infant's ability to engage in sustained attention. So that is, if the baby is playing with Piglet, and I'm over here really interested in my pen, and I'm like, look, baby, pen, there's a pen over here. Look, look, I've got a pen. We are actually redirecting their attention away from the thing that was important to them to something that's really probably not that important to them, right? Which is negatively related to their ability to sustain attention later. So what would be better for me to do is say, oh, look, you have Piglet. Look at his long ears. And it looks like a kitty has been playing with Piglet too. It's got lots of fur on it. And oh, look, Piglet has stripes on his tummy and little feet. And I'm talking about the item that the baby has. I'm coming into their attentional focus. I'm looking at what they have. Okay, that's probably a better use of your time and a better activity for encouraging attentional development and encouraging language development than trying to redirect their attention to something else. Okay, so in the absence of joint attention, infants may miss out on word learning opportunities. If we think about, if the baby is not able to jointly attend to an object, and I name it, well, they might be attending to the pen and I name Piglet, right? They're missing out on those word learning opportunities, okay? Then they may think this is Piglet for a while and then realize, oh no, wait, nobody else calls this Piglet ever. But it's kind of confusing, right? If they're not able to establish joint attention, they have a really difficult time or can have a difficult time learning the words that they need to for their lexical development. By about 16 to 19 months, infants are adept at using several cues to support inferences about a speaker's referential intentions. So line of regard, being able to follow your gaze to something. If I'm looking at something, you know, across the room and I say, oh, that's the desk chair over there. They're able to follow that. They're able to follow gestures such as pointing. They're able to follow your voice direction. If you call their name from another side of the room, they're able to attend to that. And they're able to follow body posture as well and understanding more about emotion or being able to, like if you're leaning towards something or someone, being able to attend to that. Intersubjective awareness is the recognition of when one shares a mental focus on some external object or action with another person. Now, intentional communication is the infant's attempt to deliberately communicate with you or someone else. When infants have intersubjective awareness, they begin to interpret others' referential actions as intentional and begin to use their own actions referentially. So that's a lot of words. What do we mean? Well, when children start to, or when babies start to realize that you and the baby are attending to something or you're attending to something and they can follow that, then they're able to start seeing that you have intentional communication. And likewise, they're able to start with their own intentional communication, modeling after what you're doing. So they're able to realize that you and the baby are sharing focus on something of interest to the both of you and that you're intentionally communicating about it, then they can start to intentionally communicate about it. That's when they start to do things like pointing or vocalizing and pointing or gesturing. They start to realize, oh, if I intentionally do something here, that parent is going to become a part of it, or they're going to make a comment too. And that's really important as they're learning to do that language, as they're learning language, okay? Indicators of intentionality include infant alternating eye gaze between an object and a communicative partner. We've talked about that. As in, they look at Piglet and they look back up at you and they look at Piglet again, trying to make sure that you're attending to that same thing that they're attending to. Infant using ritualized gestures such as pointing, right? That's also going to draw your attention to something and look intentional. And or they persist towards goals by repeating or modifying their gestures when communicative attempts fail. So if at first they're looking at you and looking at the object doesn't work, well then maybe they're going to point and then maybe they're going to grab your hand and bring it to something if you're still not paying attention. So those are indications that they're being intentional about their communication, which is really neat. All right. Imperative pointing are requests for adults to retrieve objects. So the cereal's on the counter and the little one walks up and points to the cereal. They're asking you for that. Declarative pointing is a social process between an infant and an adult. It's calling the adult's attention to objects and commenting on those objects, basically like, look at this. Ooh, how interesting. Look at what I found. They produce and understand declarative pointing later than they understand and produce imperative pointing. And this makes sense, right? Because we're more motivated to get our needs met than we are to converse about something. Right? And babies especially, they're egocentric. They're concerned about what's going on in their world. So, of course, they're looking at, how can I get that? If I point at it, maybe mommy's going to get it down for me. And look, lo and behold, she does, and I get it. I'm highly reinforced for that. When they do something like declarative pointing, where they're pointing at an object they're excited about, the reinforcement for that is the social interaction, which can still be very reinforcing, but it may be less reinforcing than those Cheerios or the cookie or whatever it is that they've pointed to that you've given to them, all right? Production of declarative pointing is linked to infants' understanding of others' intentions. So it shows that infants are starting to understand what other people mean when they're doing something, which is kind of neat. All right. So phase three is 1 year and beyond, and it's when they're starting to use and begin to get language itself. So children begin to incorporate their language into their communicative interactions with others. So they'll start using, like we saw in that very first video, the baby saying up, things like that. They're starting to use those first words in addition to their pointing. They're able to engage socially with others and to use language to represent events and objects within these interactions. And they have active involvement of parents and other adults is still important during this phase. So, you know, we see that all the time, right? We keep talking about it, how important the adults are in the environment, how important others are who are communicating with that child. You're important to their development. You're important to their ability to gain joint attention. You're important to their ability to start to use language. All of it's important, and you as the caregiver or somebody in the child's life, you're important for that. All right, so how does this kind of go into practice? Theories about language development and the research that these theories propagate are making an increasing impact on our parenting practices and even influence the products we buy for our infants. So, companies like Mattel and Fisher-Price, they are using language research and research about children's intentionality and ability to gain others' attention and communicate to base their products, which is really cool. And your book has a little section about this. Be sure you take a look at it. All right, the routines in infancy. Infancy is full of routines. And these routines provide a sense of comfort and predictability. And they also provide many opportunities for language learning. They provide opportunities to engage in episodes of joint attention with caregivers. By hearing words and phrases repeatedly, they learn about the sounds and structures of their language, including phonotactics and where pauses occur. If you think about some of the routines of infancy, right? Bedtime. Okay, we're gonna put our pajamas on, right? Well, we gotta put one arm in, and then we gotta put the other arm in. Now we're buttoning up all the buttons. Let's count the buttons, right? Those routines, bath time. Oh, we have to fill up the tub. Look, we have water in the bathtub. Now we have to take off our clothes, and we get in the bathtub and splash, splash, splash. We splash in the water. Oh, now we have to wash your hair. We get the shampoo and we scrub it into your scalp, and then we wash your whole body. We start with your neck and your shoulders. All those things, every time you do one of those routines, it's an opportunity for them to learn language, and hearing it over and over and over again helps them to learn those specific words. And also, the repeated information, because it's repeated over and over again, they start to really be able to break into that speech stream and understand more of the words, okay? So that's really important. So talking through diaper changes, talking through different toys that have a specific routine, talking through feeding routines. Oh, here comes your sweet potatoes. Open your mouth. Oh, you have a big open mouth. Mommy's gonna put the sweet potatoes in your mouth. Mmm, yum, those are good. Okay, all those things, if we say it over and over and over again, they're learning all that language. All right, caregiver responsiveness. Always important, right? It describes a caregiver's attention and sensitivity to an infant's vocalizations and communicative attempts. It teaches infants that others value their behaviors and communicative attempts. Consistent, contingent, and appropriate responses to an infant's communication attempts promotes a child's ability and desire to sustain long periods of joint attention and increases children's motivation to communicate. Okay. So all of us, if we feel like somebody is in tune to our communication, if we feel like they're listening, if they respond to us, we are more likely to continue to talk to them and want to be around them and want to hear what they have to say, right? So how would that be different with our babies? If we're showing them all the time that we're interested, that what they have to say is important, that all those vocalizations get a response from us, that increases those responses. If we think about Skinner and his behavioral ideas, we're reinforcing that, right? So they have a behavior. Let's just say it's the ah sound, okay? And we go, ah, oh, I love how you're talking, ah, and we make silly faces to go along with that. What do you think the baby's gonna do? Well, if they're smiling and enjoying your reaction to their ah, they're probably gonna do ah again. And then maybe you're gonna one day go ba ba, and the baby goes ba ba ba, and you throw this big party because the baby imitated you. Well, the baby's gonna continue to do those kinds of things because it was reinforced. According to Skinner, it's how we learn language, right? So when they talk about caregiver responsiveness, I love this consistent. It happens all the time. Contingent, it's contingent upon a baby's production or a baby's actions, and appropriate. So in the appropriateness, it's not just, oh yeah, you said ah, great job, right? We're talking to a baby here, those elongated vowels, the excited pitches, things like that, and that are appropriate to the context are all really important to helping them learn language, okay? More responsive language input by mothers is linked to children's language milestones, including saying their first word and producing two-word sentences. So the more that mommies respond to those, to anything the baby's doing, the more likely they are to say their first words early and produce two-word sentences. More important than an infant's own behaviors, such as their vocalizations and play, our responses to those vocalizations, our responses to the baby's actions are more important than their actual doing it, okay? So that's an important thing to remember, especially if you're out there working with the birth to three population and you're educating parents, because that's a lot of what that age group is about. reminding the parents that their job is so very important, and that the ways that they respond to their infants is even more important than the infants producing things themselves. Okay. Weitzman and Greenberg, 2002, have key indicators of caregiver responsiveness. So they are waiting and listening. So waiting for the baby to do something, gesture, vocalization, and listening to the baby. Following the child's lead, so not having your own agenda, right? That's something that, as speech therapists later on, you know, you might have your own agenda for therapy, and it's important to remember that, especially with the young ones, following their lead is going to be so much better for their language learning than trying to get through with your own agenda. If you come in to working with a nine-month-old, 12-month-old, 18-month-old, and you've got your books and you've got your stuff that you want to work on, you've got your piglet, and baby needs to be interested in my piglet, and baby goes, you know what? No, I'm not interested in your piglet, but these sunglasses, those are cool. Follow that baby's lead. You can talk about the sunglasses, right? That's really important. Joining in and playing with what they're doing. So when you see your baby interested in something, joining in on that play, being face-to-face, being sure that they can see your face when you're talking to them and make eye contact, follow your gaze, things like that. Using a variety of questions and labels, encouraging turn-taking, and expanding and extending what they say. So these kind of are a little bit of a hierarchy as well, right? Because turn-taking is a little bit of a higher skill than just joining into their play, right? And expanding and extending things that they say. If the baby says one word, like up, you could say something like, oh, you want to get up? Mommy should pick you up. Here we go. Mommy's picking you up. Okay? That's expanding and extending what they've said. So what major achievements in language content form and use are characterized in infancy? Remember, these things are coming back. We talked about them a lot in our first unit. Content, form, and use. Okay, so content, remember, is your semantics. Form is syntax, phonology, and morphology. And use are the pragmatics. So let's look at each of those and see what comes up during infancy. Okay. All right, language content. The children usually produce their first true words at about 12 months on average, okay? They usually refer to salient people and objects in the child's everyday life. So it's not usually an action word. It's usually something in their environment that they have all the time. Mommy, daddy, puppy, kitty, oma, opa. Whatever they're seeing on a really regular basis that's important to them will be those first key words. Now, a true word has a clear intention and purpose, meaning that they don't just say ball as they're just kind of looking around. There's no ball anywhere. But if they're looking at, pointing to a ball and say ball, that has clear intention and purpose. It has to be a recognizable production. So it can't be da-da for bottle, because nobody's going to recognize that. Even if they use it all the time to refer to their bottle, it's clear in their intent and they use it all the time. If nobody besides their immediate caregivers are going to understand it, it's not considered a true word. It also has to be used consistently and generalized beyond the original context to all appropriate exemplars. So, like if Roan's first word was doggy, okay, it would have to refer to his doggy, to the neighbor's doggy, to doggies in pictures, okay? It'd have to refer to all those things. All right. They must be able to generalize words to several appropriate cases for them to meet the criteria of a true word. Okay, so it doesn't have to be all cases. So if your child has, let's say, a very, very large dog, like a mastiff, okay, really, really big dog, and then they come across a little dog like my Maltese, and they're not quite sure that that's a dog, especially if she doesn't happen to be barking, they might not fully get that that little dog is a dog as well. Or the same way inversely. If Roan goes out on a walk and he sees my neighbor's Great Dane and Mastiff walking down the street, He might be more likely to think those are horses compared to his little Maltese 5-pound dog that he has here at home. Okay, but in general, it kind of generalizes to all dogs. All right? All right, language form. When infants begin to use first two words, they generally utter these words in isolation for several months before they begin to combine words to make short phrases. Okay, so there's not a whole lot in the area of form in those first 12 to 18 months because they're just single words. So we don't have a lot of grammar or things like that going on. That becomes more important as we move on through toddlerhood and preschool years. Language use. Now, there are a lot of things that babies use their language for. They communicate intentionally, usually by about 8 months of age, by using a variety of pre-verbal language functions. So seeking attention to themselves, attention seeking to events or objects or other people, requesting objects, requesting attention, requesting information, greeting, transferring, protesting and rejecting, responding and acknowledging and informing. So they're using a lot of pre-verbal language, things like pointing, gesturing, screeching, jumping up and down, reaching, right? All those things are trying to communicate something. Roan has just started reaching for us when he wants up out of his bouncer or up off the floor. He's just started that reach, pick me up. He's communicating intentionally, pick me up. I don't want to be here anymore. Come get me. So even though babies are not necessarily using words, their body language, the things that they're doing, even their vocalizations can be really intentional communication, okay? So what factors influence an infant's individual achievements in language? There are four areas that exhibit substantial variability in language development in infants. They have variations in receptive and expressive language development, variations in rate of language development, variations in infants' learning styles, and variations at the extremes of the typical range. So, variations in the receptive and expressive language development. At all stages of life, receptive language development outpaces expressive language development. Now, as you get into practicing, you might come across a child whose expressive language scores are higher than their receptive language scores. And usually, this is due to attention. Because if you think about it, you can't use more words than you understand, right? Now, you have to remember, language comprehension requires that we retrieve information, right? We don't have to express anything. But expressive language means that we have to retrieve something and then create it and produce it for ourselves and apply proper pronunciation. We have to come up with the correct grammar to use it. So it's a whole lot more complex to use expressive language than it is to use receptive language. And babies have a much greater receptive lexicon than they do expressive. You know, you'll see babies be able to say or be able to follow simple directions like give that to me before they could actually say give that to me. All right. With language comprehension, sentences are pre-organized with lexical items, a syntactic structure, and an intonation as we hear them. So sentences are already put together. You didn't have to put it together. All you have to do is understand each of the words. Language that adults use in communicative interactions with infants usually are highly contextualized, meaning that when we talk to babies, we're talking about things in their environment. There's lots of context to help them understand. When we're talking like we're talking right now, all you have to understand things are my words, my PowerPoints, and maybe a video, but there's not as much context. You're having to use all of your lexical knowledge to be able to understand what I'm saying. But with babies, we don't do that to them. We give them lots of contextual cues. I'll be holding up the piglet and say, oh, look, the piglet's pink. The baby's looking at my piglet. He's pink. He has stripes. Look, his hands are a lighter pink than his body. He has long ears. And look at that piggy snout, right? I'm pointing. I'm showing. I'm making sure that he's looking. And I'm pointing to each individual part to make sure he's got context for what I'm talking about, okay? That's what we mean by highly contextualized. Okay, so there's a variation in rate of development of language as well. Receptive language the language that the baby understands, and expressive language is what that they can produce spontaneously without imitating another's vocalizations. And so again, receptive language develops more quickly than expressive language, okay? And there are norm reference measures for language development in little ones, including the MacArthur-Bates Communicative Development Inventory. And that may be an assessment we'll take a look at if we end up having time for an assessment section of this course. All right, variation in language development continued. Okay, so two variables of interest are socioeconomic status and the quantity of talks parent provide to their children. We have talked about this and talked about this, that 30 million word gap. the amount parents talk to their children is directly related, it can be related to their socioeconomic status. Regardless of socioeconomic status, though, the more parents talk to their children, the more rapidly children's own vocabulary grows, and the better children perform on measures of verbal and cognitive competence at age three. So just because a family has a lower socioeconomic status, if the parents make a really solid point to talk with their children, then the socioeconomic status doesn't matter. But they find that in families of lower socioeconomic status, the parents are out of the home more because they have to work more, or they might have lower education levels, and so they don't know to spend a lot of time talking to their children. The kids may be watching more TV or left on their own more because there's more children to take care of and there's other things to do, right? So they do find that that's correlative, for sure, in that children who come from families of lower socioeconomic status tend to have more difficulty in their language development than children who do not. All right. There's also variations in learning styles. So expressive language learners use language primarily for social exchanges. Now, this was me. I loved the social part of language. I wanted to say hello and goodbye to everyone as I was little, express needs and describe feelings as they interact with others. These little ones really enjoy the social exchange, okay? Referential language learners use language primarily to refer to people and other objects. So these are little ones that are a little bit more concrete. They like to label things. Their early vocabularies contain a large proportion of object labels like ball and doggy and juice. So those are two different types of learners. Neither one's necessarily bad. It just is who the child is as an individual. Okay. Now, there are extreme cases in lexical development at both ends of the range. Okay, you have late talkers and early talkers. Now, late talkers are children who exhibit delays in their expressive language development. Many are able to recover to normal language levels by three or four, but they may still exhibit delays in subtle speech aspects of language development. So you might have a little boy who's two who really isn't talking much yet. But when tested, their expressive language is pretty good, receptive language is pretty good, and they've got some expressive words and their pronunciation's okay, so you know it's not apraxia of speech. They're just a little bit later in things. Maybe they're a bit more shy, maybe they're a bit more reserved and they're not into the talking, okay? Early talkers, which was, you know, me, I made my entire family say the Pledge of Allegiance at two before we could open Christmas presents. And I was using my first words before 12 months, okay? It's just different ends of the spectrum, okay? Between the ages of 11 and 21 months of age, these children are in the top 10% for vocabulary production for their age on the MacArthur CDI. Early talkers maintain an advantage over their age-matched, typically developing peers in measures of vocabulary, mean length of utterance, and verbal reasoning throughout early childhood. So if you have an early talker, chances are that they're going to actually score better in their language overall, continuing on through early childhood. Makes sense, because they're talking earlier, they're going to be using more words earlier. Okay, habituation versus dishabituation tasks. Now, these are some different, we're going to kind of look over some different research studies. Your book goes into more detail about them, and there are videos on the CD that come with your book. I don't have a personal copy of the book yet. I was going to show you those videos in this PowerPoint, but what I would like you to do is go ahead and look at those videos on the CD that comes with your book to understand these research designs a little bit better and the methods that they used. So we're going to go over this part fairly quickly because I expect that you'll be watching the videos to get more information, okay? Habituating is presenting the same stimulus repeatedly to an infant until his or her attention to the stimulus decreases by a predetermined amount, okay? So presenting a picture and a sound over and over and over again until the baby kind of starts to lose interest for a while. Dishabituation is an infant's renewed interest in a stimulus according to some predetermined threshold. So something about it changes and the baby's interest comes back, okay? It's used to determine whether infants detect differences in pre-linguistic and linguistic stimuli and to determine how infants organize these stimuli categorically. So an example of this is going to be one of the studies on your CD, so be sure you take a look at that, okay? High amplitude non-nutritive sucking procedure is one that they use in very little infants to determine their ability to hear differences in language and speech production. And so what they do is they give the baby a pacifier that has electrodes tied to it, and they kind of train the baby. They determine as the audio stimulus reinforces the infant's sucking behavior, he becomes conditioned and will suck with greater frequency when he likes the sound and will suck with less frequency when he does not like the sound or becomes bored with the sound. Okay, so they kind of teach the baby that there's a sound and the baby likes it, it'll start sucking harder, and they kind of reinforce that. And then when the baby's bored or doesn't like the sound, it doesn't suck as much. Okay, and that's used to find out information about their preferences for certain sound stimuli. That's also on your video CD, I believe. Intermodal preferential looking paradigm. Okay, infants sit on a blindfolded parent's lap, and the parent has to be blindfolded so they can't influence the baby's results, okay? About 3 feet away from a television screen. It's a split screen presentation with one stimulus on the left side of the screen and another on the right side of the screen. And the audio that accompanies the presentation matches the visual information on only one side of the screen, okay? And they look to see if the baby will look to that one side of the screen when the audio information is presented. Okay, hidden cameras record infants' visual fixation throughout the presentation. Infants will direct a greater amount of visual attention to the matching side of the screen when they understand the language they hear. And this one is for sure on your CD as well, so go ahead and take a look at that. This one is the same kind of thing, only there's a board with objects that are affixed to it, okay? And the researcher flips the board to control when and how long the infant views the objects on the board, okay? And the objects, the baby's able to manipulate the objects for a specified amount of time. And then the salience trials measure whether the infant has a priori preference for one of the objects over the other. In the training phase, the experimenter attempts to teach the infant the name of a new object. In the test trials, determine whether the infant has mapped the object name to the correct object. So when the researcher flips the board, after they've taught the baby the name of the item, they flip the board, and if the infant pays better attention to the item that they name, then they know that the baby is actually mapping or gaining the name of that particular object, okay? The hidden cameras record infants' looking time throughout the experiment, and if infants understand the language they hear, they look longer to the side of the apparatus containing the target object. Okay, another way that we research babies' language is through naturalistic observation, okay? So they take place usually in the infant's home. They videotape, audio tape, take notes, or any combination as infants interact naturally with the things around them. Now, if you have a semi-structured or structured observation in the laboratory, you're targeting specific language forms or pre-linguistic behaviors. You're going to set up the environment for eliciting those kinds of things. Specific props, or you ask the same questions of all the infants as a point of comparison, okay? And you can use the Child Language Data Exchange System database to look at lots and lots of research, not you personally, but researchers use the Child Language Data Exchange System to look at lots and lots of research that have been done in the area and are able to analyze it, okay? How do clinicians measure language development in infants, okay? In general, this is difficult to gauge. It's difficult to gauge whether children are lagging behind in their language skills until they reach toddlerhood, when their expressive language truly begins to emerge, okay? Two informal measures of language development that clinicians utilize with infants are informal language screenings and parent report measures, okay? Informal language screenings usually include checklists where clinicians and parents can check off whether or not the infant exhibits each of the behaviors in question. Usually, you're going to say what they can do right now, not really looking in the past, because they tend to be a much better reporter of things that are current rather than things that are in the past, okay? And parent reports, parents report directly to their on their infant's development. It's a quick way to gauge infant progress, and it can be a reliable and valid measure of language ability when compared to other direct assessments. They're usually checklists and questionnaires, including the Language Development Survey and the MacArthur-Bates Communicative Development Inventories. All right, we did it. We made it through all of the infant development. So, you're going to have a discussion board and assignments to go along with this week, and then we're going to discuss it a little bit more in class this week as well. I've got some exciting things, hopefully, for your class this week, so I'm really looking forward to that and looking forward to seeing you. I hope you enjoyed this lecture, and be sure that if you have any questions, you post them on the question discussion board, and I'll look forward to seeing you later this week.